dismissed. We hold on, Luke and Anna Claire, don't go anywhere yet. Yesterday was the 1 year anniversary that Craig and Jackie Dias became mom and dad to Luke and Anna Claire. That's something to celebrate. Now go. Precious. For those of you who have been wondering, Cheryl's mom is doing well. They actually had to take out more tissue than they had originally believed, but they believe they got all the cancer with the chemo and everything else. So still not sure. I'm assuming, but I haven't gotten final word, that they will be doing radiation. That was one thing that was originally in the mix, so I'm assuming that's still part of the issue. So continue to pray for that situation. Hopefully Cheryl will come home to me this week, and that would be great. I'd like that. So pray for her safe travel also. I just realized I forgot to put our verses in this week, and there was a verse I was going to substitute. Christian and I talked about it the other night, and now I can't remember what it was. So forgive me for that. We'll just have to skip those this week, because you know me, if I try to quote them, I'll forget something. I'll insert somebody's name somewhere or something. I don't know, but we'll just move ahead. Turn with me, if you will, to 1 Corinthians chapter 7. 1 Corinthians chapter 7. We're getting deep into the book of 1 Corinthians. We've seen so far the first two major sections dealing, first of all, with church division, secondly, with church disorder. And today we're going to move into this third section. It's actually the final section, which deals with church difficulties. Now, just by way of review, I'm going to do this very quickly if I can, because something I was thinking about over the last day or so was just how much, though it's not mentioned other than in the opening statement of Paul's letter here, how much the grace of God can be seen through the book of 1 Corinthians. With the difficulties and the outright open sin that we see being addressed in this letter, yet all of it is bathed in the grace of God. Paul's not telling these people, hey, you've lost your salvation. Hey, because you're doing this, God is casting you out. Or, you know, hey, because you're doing this, you're just not saved. He's not doing any of that. He's just pointing out what is going wrong with the church and trying to redirect them to what they need to be doing, the new life they need to be living, because they are new creatures in Christ. So in the opening section, he identifies himself and he reminds them that they have been sanctified in Christ Jesus, that by calling, by their very calling, they are saints or holy ones in Christ, and that he prays for them that the grace and peace of God the Father and the Lord Jesus Christ would continually be theirs. He offers thanks for them. Because as we find out that later that they are his children in the Lord Jesus Christ. So this is look at it this way, a father writing a letter to his children who have gone astray, or at least some have. And he begins, if you recall back in chapter 1 in verse 10, by exhorting them to come together to be made complete, or to speak the same thing and be in the same mind and in the same judgment in Christ, because he found out that divisions had taken place in the church. He reminds them that when he came to them, he didn't use persuasive speech, this haughty speech or fancy linguistics or anything like that to explain some high and lofty philosophy to them. He came with the simple gospel of Jesus Christ. And in chapter 2, he says, the reason I did that, the reason I came to you in this manner, not using lofty speech, not giving to you these high-sounding philosophies of men, is so that when you believed, it would be based solely upon the power of God through the gospel of Jesus Christ. In chapter 2, verse 3, he says, I was with you in weakness and in fear and in much trembling, and my message and preaching were not in persuasive words of wisdom, but in demonstration of the Spirit and of power, so that your faith would not rest on the wisdom of men, but on the power of God. And he goes on and tries to redirect their attention away from the wisdom of men or man-made philosophies and back to the simplicity of the gospel of Jesus Christ and the teaching that flows out of that, the teaching of the Christian life. And he tries to redirect them into how to live as a Christian because they have accepted that gospel of Jesus Christ. But he reminds him in chapter 3, look, I couldn't speak to you as mature believers. He said, I had to speak to you as if you were infants in Christ. I couldn't give you solid food because you were still carnal. You were still saved men living lifestyles of the lost. Lifestyles of the lost and famous. That's what they were. He tries to remind them that, look, you've made these divisions lining up behind individual teachers like myself or like Apollos or like Peter, or even using Christ as a divisive instrument in the church. He said, but you have to understand, we're just the ones who I planted, Apollos watered. We're just fellow workers. We're co-workers of Christ, and you are his building, and we are trying to build you up. We're nothing more than servants of the Most High God. There is no division in Christ. You are a temple of the living God as the body of Christ, he reminds them. So he says in chapter 3, verse 21, let no man boast in men, for all things belong to you, whether Paul or Apollos or Cephas or the world or life or death or things present or things to come, all things belong to you. You belong to Christ, and Christ belongs to God. So there's no division in the body of Christ. All these things will be ours. And Paul or Apollos or Jim or Steve or David or Mike or Christopher, we all belong to you. We're servants of Jesus Christ given to help build the body of Christ. And so that's what he starts off with in chapter 4, that every man needs to regard us in this manner, that we are servants of Christ and stewards of the mystery of Christ. As he works his way through, we come to chapter 5. Actually, at the end of chapter 4, he reminds them, look, be imitators of me. Not me, Paul. Not me. Do as I say, not as I do, okay? But Paul would say, do as I do. Wouldn't that be a great testimony for all of us to be able to say, hey, just follow me, do what I do. I will never tell you that. I would like to be able to. He chastises them for becoming arrogant. He brings it over into chapter 5 that arrogance is displayed in the fact that there's this horrific sexual sin going on in the church, and they're not only not dealing with it, they're celebrating it because they think it demonstrates that they've reached some pinnacle of spirituality. And Paul chastises them and said, look, this guy needs to be put out of the church until he comes to his senses. So next time you come together, put this man out of the church. As a matter of fact, I told you in the past not to associate with the immoral people or swindlers or idolaters, all those people. And he says, I wasn't speaking of the people in the world, the lost people. I was speaking of people in the church. Kind of nips that whole idea that Christians no longer sin in the bud, does it not? He comes down into chapter 6, and he chastises them because of the practice of taking each other to court in the presence of the lost world instead of someone being in the church who is mature enough to arbitrate these issues that come up. And he says, look, if there's no one mature enough in the church, then why don't you just suck it up and be wronged? It'd be better for you to lose your own property or whatever the issue is than to take a brother or sister to court in front of a lost world. And then one of the pinnacle parts of the book of 1 Corinthians is found in chapter 6, verses 9, 10, 11. He says, "Do you not know that the unrighteous will not inherit the kingdom of God? Do not be deceived. Neither fornicators, nor idolaters, or adulterers, or the effeminate, or homosexuals, nor thieves, nor the covetous, nor drunkards, nor revilers, nor swindlers will inherit the kingdom of God." And then those great words, "Such were some of you. But you were washed, you were sanctified, you were justified in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ and in the Spirit of our God." This is his call to them. This is who you are now. You are no longer the drunkard. You are no longer the sexual immoral person. You are no longer a thief or an effeminate or a homosexual, any of that. You are a new creature in Christ. And he is going to exhort them to live like new creatures in Christ, because as he says in verse 20, "For you have been bought with a price." You have been deemed valuable enough to have been purchased by the unquantifiably great blood of Jesus Christ. Therefore, glorify God in your body. And then he brings that theme into chapter 7, only because obviously they had sent questions to him concerning more issues within the church. So read with me, if you will, beginning in verse 1 of chapter 7. "Now concerning the things about which you wrote, it is good for a man not to touch a woman, but because of immoralities, each man is to have his own wife, and each woman is to have her own husband. The husband must fulfill his duty to his wife, and likewise also the wife to her husband. The wife does not have authority over her own body, but the husband does. And likewise also the husband does not have authority over his own body, but the wife does. Stop depriving one another, except by agreement for a time, so that you may devote yourselves to prayer and come together again, so that Satan will not tempt you because of your lack of self-control. But this I say by way of concession, not of command. Yet I wish that all men were even as I myself am. However, each man has his own gift from God, one in this manner and one and another in that. But I say to the unmarried and to the widows that it is good for them if they remain even as I. But if they do not have self-control, let them marry, for it is better to marry than to burn with passion." Father, we thank you for your word and ask that we would handle it correctly today, and that you would use it to build us up as the body of Christ. Father, help us to be holy in every thought, word, and deed, so that we might bring you glory with all of our being. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, so with the words, "Now concerning your questions," the Greek peri-dei is what it actually is, we find that Paul is now turning his attention to the questions that had been brought to him from the church in Corinth. And the first thing that we see is Paul answering questions of relationships. One thing that probably, I wish I had addressed this a few weeks ago, in verses 9, 10, 11, but I'll deal with it now because it's still very relevant to the topic at hand here in this chapter, are the sexual ethics of Corinth, the city of Corinth. And what historians have found is that, of course, we know that with the different pagan rituals and pagan practices, there was all kinds of sexual immorality going on in that day. But especially for our case here, Corinth, the typical practice would be that in a marriage relationship, the husband would have relations with his wife simply for procreative purposes. But he was not bound to that. The typical social practice was to have those relations in order to have children, to propagate your family name, but then to have recreational relations with people outside of marriage. so that the husband and wife would only come together occasionally, but the husband, more often than the wife, the husband would be involved with relations outside of marriage. And so that verses 9, 10, 11 of chapter 6 really focus in on that. And typically, what would happen is that the husband, sometimes the wife was not prohibited from this, but it was more often the husband, would have relations with women or men or children outside of the marital relationship for recreational purposes. This is what Paul is writing into. This is what he is trying to demonstrate for them that is completely anathema to the Christian life. And so it seeps over into the church, obviously, from what we saw from the previous chapters, but also the questions that we see today in this passage, because some of them, it seems, were thinking, okay, these relations, they're sinful, and therefore we just need to abstain altogether. So it's good for a man not to touch a woman. And touch there doesn't mean touch. It means to have relations with a woman. And so the question arises. Some are going to think on one hand, they see themselves as so spiritual that those relationships, no big deal. It's not going to harm my spirit, so I can engage. And then the other end of the spectrum were those who are saying, well, these relationships are sinful, so we should just abstain even within the marriage bonds. We should abstain from that. And so Paul has to deal with these issues. And so he comes to answer those questions. And the first question he's addressing are answers for the married and the single people. So in verse 1, he says, now concerning the things about which you wrote, it is good for a man not to touch a woman, but because of immoralities, each man is to have his own wife, and each woman is to have her own husband. So the first thing he's going to address is concerning celibacy. So the question, at least some believe that this phrase, it is good for a man not to touch a woman, was a phrase that had arisen in the church in Corinth. So it's kind of like a catchphrase for the church or some people within the church. And so Paul is going to answer that. And he says, well, yes, it is good for a man not to touch a woman. In other words, it's good for a man not to have relationship with a woman, a physical relationship. But it's not necessarily better, and it's not necessarily recommended. Okay? So what does he say? He said, yes, it's good for a man not to touch a woman, but that's called an adversative. In other words, yeah, that's good. However, but it's not likely to happen. Celibacy is a good thing, but it's not morally superior than the marriage relationship. And he says that he inserts that phrase because of the immoralities. And I think that it's possible that in the Greek, the word, the definite article is there. And I think he's pointing back to what he just mentioned in verses 9 and 10. But regardless, he's talking about all kinds of sexual immoralities. Because of that, each man is to have his own wife, and each woman must have her own husband. Now, this is a Greek word there, if you're wondering, exeto, to have. It's the imperative, and grammarians say that this is what is called a hortative. In other words, he's giving them, it's not just a suggestion, but it may not be a full-fledged command, everyone must be married, because he makes the exceptions here. But he's saying, look, it's going to be very unlikely that the man is not going to be able to abstain from sex. The woman is not going to be able to abstain from that relationship. Therefore, because of these immoralities that are all around you, have you ever noticed that? Am I the only one that notices that? I mean, commercials. I don't even have cable anymore. Not necessarily by choice. I mean, it is by choice, but because I didn't want to pay for it. So you don't get a lot of commercials, but you don't have to. I go to get my hair cut in the barbershop, and there's a good Christian man owns this barbershop. And I go in there, and the magazines, you can't look at the magazines. I mean, it could be home and garden. And you're going to have a half-naked woman in there somewhere. You don't even have to look for them, believe me. And our whole society reflects a very similar attitude towards these relations as Corinth did. And so because of that, the temptation that is out there, he says, because of that temptation, each man, I'm going to take that must out. I'm going to say each man should. It would be advisable. You better do it or you're going to possibly fall into trouble. Each man should have his own wife and each wife should have her own husband. Now, there are some implications here that we need to look at. You can see right off the bat that the biblical standard for these relationships is one man, one woman. He doesn't have to come out and say it. He does. I mean, he just, verses 9 and 10 of chapter 6, he's already said, talked about homosexuality and all that. But this is one man, one woman. How do I know that? Well, because it's pretty obvious. Because of these immoralities, each man, that's, it's a great time to go blank. Masculine, that's a masculine noun. Each man is to have his own wife. That's a feminine noun. And each wife, that's a feminine noun, must have her own husband. That's a masculine noun. It's pretty much a no-brainer. It doesn't take, you don't have to be a scientist. You don't have to be a philosopher. You don't have to be an activist. You don't have to be an idiot. It's very clear. This is all based upon the male-female relationship and the way God created things. But not only that, it prohibits things such as polygamy. How do I know that? Because each man is to have his own wife, singular. Each man, singular, must have his own wife, singular. Each woman, singular, must have her own husband, singular. And so this pretty much takes care of all the sexual issues in this world. The limitations that are put on there. And so what we see is that not only is sex not prohibited, which some of them thought, it's encouraged, it's good, it's necessary for holy living. All the men said amen. My wife is going to get me for that one. Well, the next thing we see here is concerning the physical obligations within the marriage bonds. The husband, he says in verse 3, must fulfill. Now notice those words must. This is an imperative. Must fulfill his duty. And there are a series of imperatives in here that he gives to govern relationships between the man, woman, husband, wife. And so the husband must fulfill his duty to his wife. And likewise, also the wife to her husband. The wife does not have authority over her own body, but the husband does. And likewise, also, the husband does not have authority over his own body, but the wife does. So let's just stop and look at that for a moment. It's real simple. There are mutual obligations within the marriage relationship. This must fulfill. The words must fulfill, it's literally, it must fulfill your obligation. The word is literally means your obligation, not just duty, but it's your obligation to your wife, and wife to your husband. It's a present imperative, which means it's a habitual duty for the husband and wife to come together and fulfill these obligations within the marriage relationship. So the idea that some of them had that this physical relationship was evil and should be prohibited altogether, Paul's just knocked it out of the park. But also, those who believe that it's no big deal because I'm spiritually mature, it's not going to hurt my spirit, Paul knocks that out of the park also because he binds it within the marriage relationship. And that's where it must remain. We also see an inverted authority here. I like that term. I came up with that term myself. I thought it sounded neat. I have no idea what it means. Inverted authority says the wife does not have authority over her own body, but the husband does. And the husband does not have authority over his own body, but the wife does. In other words, that's what it says, and we'll move on. Just leave it alone. Just move on. Well, the next thing we see is questions concerning the unmarried and the widows. Well, you know what? I need to go back because I didn't deal with verses 6 and 7, did I? Look at what he says there in verse 5. Good night, I missed all those. Where did my notes go? I guess I didn't put that in there. Interesting. Anyway, well, let's deal with it anyway. I was just trying to get out of dealing with all this. This is what it was. David's teaching next week. Anyway, so verse 5. Look what he says. Stop depriving one another. That word deprive, it means to rob someone. Stop robbing one another. What's he talking about? In the physical relationship within the marriage. Stop depriving one another, except, here's an exception, by agreement for a time so that you may devote yourselves to prayer and come together again so that, and here's the purpose. First of all, we have temptations. We have our own sinful temptations within ourselves. We don't need Satan's help. But, obviously, from what he says here, that these relations help to protect against satanic temptation that based upon our lack of self-control. Wow, okay. So that marriage relationship, when the man and woman come together, it helps to avert satanic temptation. This is in the subjunctive mood, so it could be saying that when you come together, if you make it a common practice when you do this, it may help to avert Satan's temptation that is based upon your own lack of self-control. But notice what he says in verse 6. But, another adversative, I need to turn things around here a little bit. You need to know this. I say this by way of concession, not of command. What is he talking about? Go back to verse 5. Stop depriving one another. That's not what he's talking about. But what he's talking about is when he says, except by agreement for a time so that you may devote yourselves to prayer and come together again. In other words, this temporary celibacy within a marriage relationship. He says, I say do that, but I only say it by way of concession, not of command. There is no command that you abstain from this relationship within marriage. He said, I'm doing that as a concession to those of you who wish to take a period of time to devote to prayer. And that's the limit. So it's a mutual thing. He said, you do it by agreement in verse 5, and you do it so that you can devote yourselves to prayer. But other than that, I'm not making a rule that says that relationship must not take place within the marriage. I'm only doing that for a concession for those of you who wish to do what is listed in verse 5. And then in verse 7, he says this, yet, another, I wish that all men were even as I myself am. However, each man has his own gift from God, one in this manner and another in that. So in other words, Paul is saying, I'm single. At least at this point, he's saying, I'm single. Maybe his wife had died or maybe he'd never been married. There's all kinds of questions about that. He said, I really wish you all could be like me and not need a husband, not need a wife. But, he says, not all of you have that gift. God has gifted us in different ways. And so he carries this idea over into verse 8, dealing with questions of the unmarried and the widows. Verse 8, he says, but I say to the unmarried and to the widows that it is good for them to remain, that if they remain even as I, unmarried. But if they do not have self-control, let them marry, for it is better to marry than to burn with passion. So here's what he's saying. It's good to remain single if possible. If you're able to do it, Paul says, hey, that's awesome. And he's going to explain why in later verses here. Hopefully next week we'll get to that. But just preview, he said, because if you remain unmarried, you can totally devote yourself to God without any peripheral issues. In other words, the man who's married has to also devote himself to his wife. And the woman who's married has to also devote herself to the cares of her husband. But if you're single, you can devote yourself solely to service of the Lord. And so he said, it's good to remain single if you can, but, verse 9, if you can't, marry. There's another imperative. Marry. Let them marry. So in other words, if you don't have that gift of celibacy, Paul says you need to be married. And they didn't have the internet back then, so there wasn't any dating sites for you to go to. So I guess they had to do it the old-fashioned way. Guys met them the first day of college. So, well, that's what I did anyway. She's been my prisoner ever since. Anyway, so there you go. There are some questions that he answers concerning relationships. Those are some important points that we can draw from this. And real simple, celibacy is a gift that few people have. That's pretty clear. Paul, I think Paul makes that really clear. The intimacy in marriage is good and necessary for holiness. Also, the temporary abstinence in marriage is permissible but not recommended. You notice that's why he said this, I say by way of confession, or excuse me, concession, not as a command. Because Paul knew that it's not a recommended practice. It's allowable, but if you go back up there where Paul says, you know, all things are lawful for me, but not all things are profitable. I think Paul would apply that here. This temporary abstinence within a marriage, if you're coming together and you're deciding to do this so that you can spend this time in prayer, okay, you can do that, but then you really need to make sure there's a time where you cut that off, cut that time period off, and come back together. The fourth thing we see is that remaining single is a positive, but only if one is gifted with the ability to remain abstinent. And then finally, all of this is predicated upon one man, one woman for life. Now, we're going to get into divorce and remarriage and all that, Lord willing, next week. As I said, David will be teaching. And you didn't know that, did you? Well, I just thought I'd announce that for everyone. But anyway, Father, we thank you for your word to us and pray that we would learn to live in total obedience to it. Lord, as we come together to celebrate the Lord's Supper this morning, as we remember, recall, bring to mind all that is involved in that that represents, Lord, we pray that we would glorify you at this time. And we thank you for the sacrifice that our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ made to pay the penalty for our sin. We thank you for the Spirit that you left to indwell each of us, so that we could be united in love towards one another and towards you, and that we might be empowered to live in obedience to your word. And we pray that you would help us to live holy, separate lives, Lord. We fail. I fail so often, Father. And I pray for strength for each of us, for wisdom and strength to live in a manner that brings you glory. And Father, also give us a zeal to share the gospel with those who are lost, who need to hear it. We pray for our nation, Lord, and we see all the things going on around where groups are purposefully trying to start civil war and trying to physically damage those who disagree with them. And Father, we pray against that and pray that a revival would take place in our nation, that your church would return to the sufficiency, inerrancy, infallibility and trustworthiness of your word as our only guide for life each day. And may we reflect through our lifestyle the teaching that is found in your word. Lord, bless this day for your honor and your glory. In Jesus' name, amen. Please stand and sing with me.
Wonderful, merciful Savior, precious Redeemer and friend. Who would have thought that a lamb could rescue the souls of men? Oh, you rescue the souls of men. Comforter, Counselor, Keeper, Spirit we long to embrace. You offer hope when our hearts have hopelessly lost the way. Oh, we've hopelessly lost the way. You are the one that we praise. You are the one we adore. You give the healing and grace our hearts always hunger for. Oh, our hearts always hunger for. Almighty infinite Father, faithfully loving your own, here in our weakness you find us falling before your throne. Oh, we're falling before your throne. You are the one that we pray. Always hunger for.
Amen. You may be seated. Well, as is our practice,